I have co-founded it. And in my presentation, I don't want to bore you here, and so in approximately like 15 minutes, I will just show you a couple of slides about the Basecamp and then the use cases we have worked on in our first batch. So I will start with a little bit about me, so you know who I am. My name is, as I already told you, my name is Juraj, and I have studied applied mathematics in Czech Republic, and I went to University of Vienna for an Erasmus, and I found a job here in Vienna during my studies, so I stayed here. And before I co-founded my own company, I worked at Seradata as a data science consultant, and I worked on a project, you know, like for Vodafone, Metro, and companies like top 200 companies in the world based on their revenue and stuff like that. But then I met with my friend accidentally here in Vienna, and we decided to do something on our own. So we founded Noid, which is a data science consulting business as well. And then after 6 months or so, we decided to start with the Basecamp. So, what is the Basecamp? Basecamp is the immersive full-time 8-week program for prospective data scientists. So we are trying to teach data science. We are doing it like we do it in 8 weeks. It is a full-time program. And why did we decide to start this? So me and Lukas, the other co-founder of the program, we studied together in Czech Republic applied mathematics. And the most practical thing we did there was like to compute what is the shape of the power supply cable, and you put it to the 2 points, what is the shape of that. So by the way, it's arcs of cosine gains, and that was like the most practical thing we did there. Until the one professor came there who used to work in a fintech company before, and he was the only one who did it from the practical point of view. The course was then called data mining. And he introduced us to SAS, he introduced us to credit scoring and things like this. And 80% of my friend ended up in doing data science after the university, but it was basically an accident that we signed up for this course, which was voluntary only. So I don't know what me and our friends would do if we didn't meet this professor at school. But fortunately we did, so yeah, and we decided that it should not be, it's very hard to study data science in Eastern Europe or in Austria and Eastern Europe, because there is no program at the university like which is focused on that topic. You can study math or you can study computer science, but we know that data science is something in between, and yeah, so we are trying to tackle that problem. So everyone who wants, then they can understand. So here you can see the curriculum of the program. We are trying to cover all the aspects from practical point of view. So the exercises are in Python, and we have some trainings, we have some lectures, we have some practical exercises and stuff like that. But why we think that the Basecamp is special and it's different from other bootcamps which are already there. Only a few in Europe, but there are some of them, there are many of them in the US. But why we think this is special is so that we have partners which gives us the real data and the real problem, and all the participants are assigned one project in the beginning of the program, and they work on the real problem, on the real data sets during the course. And at the end, we organize a hiring day when we invite the companies from the Austria or from the Germany or from the all Europe if they are interested to come. And the participants present their results. And if companies like the solution and they like the guys who work on this, then they can also already hire them on the hiring day. So we are trying to basically bridge the gap between the university education and real life by learning people to do data science properly on real life problems. And this was it from the introduction to the Basecamp part, and now I will come to do more interesting stuff. And those are two projects, the two most interesting ones from the first batch, which happened in Vienna from this January to March. And the second one will be in June, so we are only starting, but we have already some nice results from the first batch. So we have two projects. One is from the start. One was for the startup Scudit, and one was for Casafari. And I will show you like these use cases now. So project number one was Scudit, which is a startup. I will show you the main idea of the startup on the next slide. But basically, the topic of the project was the visual recognition of cooking ingredients. So we had to, one of our participants had to build a deep learning engine which classified the picture as a tomato, for example, or potato, or whatever ingredient you go there. So how it works, this is the idea of Scudit, this is from their website, you can check it out there if you want. So you can either snap your ingredients in the fridge, or you can speak to your phone, which it's still like, still a little bit weird to speak to our phone even with all these personal assistants we have. So the snapping is, in my opinion, a better idea. Then the app will show you what you can cook from it, and then you can just cook it. So they did the school did a research that the people throw like I don't know how many tons of food per year, and they are trying to solve it because usually you don't have an idea what you want to cook. So with this app you can just open the fridge, take some pictures, and it will tell you like, okay, we can cook spaghetti bolognese. So this is the idea of the Scudit. And this is the pipeline of the framework. And the red rectangle is what was the scope of our project. So we had the pictures from, we took the base from the ImageNet, maybe you heard the competition, which is annually, it takes every year, and then there was a category for food, and then there was some deep learning magic in the middle, which assigns the proper labels to the different foods, and then based on this there is another algorithm which connects this to the recipes, but this was outside the scope of the project. Why deep learning? I mentioned the ImageNet classification problem before, and every year the best deep learners in the world are trying to achieve the best accuracy on more than 100,000 pictures, and the red line is the human performance, so it is around 95% of the humans are able to correctly assign 95% of pictures. But since the deep learning came out in 2012, the algorithms actually get really better, and finally in 2015 they improved, they were better than humans in recognizing pictures. So that's why the deep learning is now state of art for the image classification, and if you want to have an accurate algorithm, you need to use the deep learning. So what were the results? So we had an ImageNet validation set with 10,000 images. So these were images downloaded from the internet, and our participants achieved the accuracy of 92% in top 5. So this is the same evaluation principle that is used in ImageNet. So if algorithm classifies the correct label in top 5, then it is considered as correct. It usually works like, okay, you have an app, and you take a picture of the carrot, and then you see three options in there, like, okay, is it carrot, is it ketchup, or is it tomato, and you just click on the one in this. So that's why the top 5 accuracy is considered as an evaluation for the image classification problems. And then we had our own validation set, which was actually pictures from our phone, and it was 80%, and I will show you, it's written here that many images are accepted as friends from short videos, and that decreased the accuracy significantly, but I will show you some examples, so you will see what happens. So here we have the example of top 5, top 1. So that means that the model took the, like, assigned the correct label on the first try, like the top 1. So we can see here the, you cannot read it, I cannot read it as well, but here we can see the zucchini. This is a melon cantaloupe, and it says that 99% it is model cantaloupe and 0.01% is a coconut. So these are the pictures which were classified correctly. This is carrot, eggs, and yeah, so these are the examples. Then we have top 2, top 5. That means that on the first try the model was wrong, but he hit the correct label between the top and 5 range. So here we can see, for example, the butter crowd, and this is an interesting example, which is a ketchup bottle. Okay, and ketchup is on the second place, but on the first place is a butter cup, which, because the bottle is in the same shape of as a butter cup here, so the model actually thought that this is a butter cup, but in the second guess was ketchup. And here these were cherry tomatoes, but the first guess of the model was ketchup, because it saw the red color with white label on it, which it thought that it is like a label of the ketchup bottle. So we said that, okay, this is, I am sure this is a ketchup, but maybe it could be cherry tomatoes. And then there were some examples which were not as close, so the wrong ones. And here is the example of the picture from the video. So even a human cannot tell what this is. So the examples like this took the overall classification percentage down. But for this, the model was really confused by the net, which is around the potatoes. Here, there's a lot of plastic around the grapes, so it wasn't sure what it is. This is a kiwi, but from a different perspective. Quite easy for human to recognize, but model had a problem with it. So this was the first example. On the first use case, it worked on during the program, one of our students did. And the second one is the Casafari, which is a startup from Spain. And they are trying to use machine learning to make to match real estate offers. So imagine that you have 2 million euros to spend and you want to buy a property in Spain. And you don't know what to do now, and okay, you can go to search the web and you can find some ideas in some real estate agencies, but how do you know that the offer is actually good, or if they want to screw you? So when you are not there, they can easily recognize that okay, some rich guy from abroad is coming to buy a property, and that they could screw you over, and this is the problem which the Casafari is trying to take them. So there is almost no exclusive listings. Exclusive, I mean that only one real estate agency has this property. So the most of them are shared. So more than one property has this. More than one real estate agency has this property available, and Casafari, They are scraping all these properties and matching them together to find the best one. But there is a problem with this, because it's hard, if you have 100,000 properties, it's hard to say which two are the same ones. So we developed a machine learning algorithm which can classify whether the two offers are the same property or not. For that, we use the pairwise comparison. So this was our initial set with some features about the houses, which was like, okay, number of bedrooms, square meters, size, square meters. Then we had some pictures, we had some descriptions, and stuff like that. And from that, we built a new dataset with the new features and the label. Label was 0 or 1, so it was a classic classification problem or binary classification problem, and And the new features could be, for example, has the same number of bathrooms. So if the if it was three bathrooms in one residential and three bathrooms in the other one, then it was one, otherwise zero, or it could be a difference in the square footage and stuff like that. So using and what type of features we have. So we had basic descriptions, and this is these are some interesting numbers. Then 16% of cases which were the same property, the number of bedrooms was different. So you cannot really rely only on this basic description, even more in bathrooms. So in 25% of cases, it was the same property from the different real estate agencies, and one agency claimed that it has one bathroom, and the other agency claimed it has three bathrooms. So anyway, these features are important, but you cannot rely only on them. So we use also the other ones, like the descriptions. This is a real example of one villa somewhere in Spain. And we can see that they are slightly different, but they are definitely describing the same property. So we use the TDIDM algorithm. I don't know if you know it. You can talk about it after if you are interested. We check the frequency of the words which are used in some sentences against the overall frequency in the full text, and they can find out whether the text are similar or not based on the keywords. So the third class of the features are images. So again, these two, for human, it's quite obvious that it is the same house, even if we are missing this tree here. I don't know actually why it is. Maybe they cut it down, and this is from a different time period or something. But we can see the pool in the shape of L, also here. So for human, it's quite obvious. But we need to also build a kind of an image recognition or image comparison engine to actually compare, are they the same images or not. And there are no problems in this, because these are at least taken from the same site. But imagine if someone took this house from the other side, then the model would probably say that it is a different house, and no matter how good would your algorithm be. So you cannot rely only on one part of these features. You need to combine them all. And what was the goal? What was the goal of Casafari, and what we delivered? Was basically this. This is what they want to implement in their app. So you download, you have 90 million to spend, and you want to buy this house. They can save you 200,000 for you. If you use Casafari, by choosing the correct agency, you can save some money. So that was the Casafari, and I would like to end with two things, which I think are the most interesting for you. So we are always looking for partners which can provide us this, like the interesting problems like we have here. And how it works is usually that one of the participants work on it during the program under the supervision of the mentors, which are always there present. And we can deliver also some nice prototypes for maybe for your problems. From my experience, I know that it is usually, if you work in the data science department in different companies in Vienna or in the area around Vienna, there are always some small projects which you put aside and you say like, okay, I will come back to this in when I have time, but you never have time because the other projects come and stuff like this. So if you have a project like this and you would like to know what you could do with it, this offers pretty cheap solution, because no matter how good the mentors are, no matter how much experience we have, it will still be the student who will be working on the problem. So it's way cheaper than to use a proper outsourcing company or a consulting company. So if you are interested or you have a problem you would like to cheaply solve, possibly for free, just just talk to me afterwards. The other thing, we are hiring and we are looking for a mentor who could teach in our next base camp, which starts in June. So if you like to talk about data science and about machine learning, and you are very good in Python, scikit-learn, then feel free to talk to me afterwards. I would be happy to work with you. And if it's not a full time, I'm looking for a freelancer. And maybe 60-70% of the commitment would be required in June and July. With, of course, if you like it and there is a mutual interest, we can cooperate further. But the first offer would be for June and July. So if you are interested in this, please let me know afterwards. And that's all from me. Thank you for your attention.
For the other thing, Eric, I'm just 5 minutes. Okay, I called you. Now would be time to do maybe a short question and an answer for this. So any questions to that?
How many people do you have in the course?
So in the first one we had 4. And our goal was to have 8 to 10, but we actually had 20 applications for the first one, and we selected 8, but they just didn't come. So it was our learning for us that we need to ask for a confirmation way early. So now we have it because we actually had a people wait on the waiting list. But you cannot say the application was from all over the world, and you cannot say someone in India or Arabic to okay come in 2 days to Vienna because someone dropped out. So now we are asking for confirmation like way earlier, so actually people on the waiting list have a chance to come as well.
So is this the maximum capacity you have in?
Yeah, the maximum would be between 8 and 10 because otherwise it would be very hard to find a good project for everyone, and it would like the quality would decrease.
Anybody else? If not, I have a question.
There is one question.
You mentioned it's full time effort. What does it mean? Like a job?
It's
like a university.
Yeah, like university. It's 3 weeks in the morning, then there is a one break for lunch in 3 hours in the morning. 3 hours in the morning, then 1 hour for lunch and 3 hours in the afternoon.
Format like come here, do that, be present in person.
Yes, so definitely the commitment, because if you have to come every day somewhere, then when you come to our class, you actually spend the time on a project, because you cannot do anything else while you are sitting there. Then myself, I did a lot of Coursera courses. I do every month, I do a couple of them, but I finish only one. And I really, really is a problem for a lot of people that actually it is hard to commit to sit behind the computer. And you said old schools, but actually there are a lot of boot camps coming back now. So it's kind of coming big, and I don't know if you heard, but what we believe is the main difference is actually this project work. So we have a structure, like the 30% of these 8 weeks are dedicated to do independent project work. Mm-hmm. Of course, the mentors are there asking, okay, do you need help, how is it going, mm-hmm. and stuff like this, helping to communicate with the actual stakeholders of the project. But the people who were working on this were actually in slave teams of the clients, mm-hmm. and they were talking to actual people in the company like it would be a consulting project, mm-hmm. but we were kind of responsible for the solution. So they were not responsible, but they need to make a deadline, because there was a deadline, so they need to make the deadline, they need to learn how to communicate if there are problems, and if they are late, which one of them was, so they had to, before the hiring day, because you need to present the result of the hiring day, so he needed to work like if he was late in a real work.
Mm.
So he worked like last 3 days, he worked like 12 hours on the project, so he actually can deliver the presentation.
I don't know the feeling. No. I think nobody can help that.
Me personally, it happened to me that I was leaving the office at midnight when I was on the client side.
So yeah, then I think that. Yeah. So it's commitment.
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
Mm.